Good morning. So Antonio started out this morning telling us that we live in a change of era. I would also like to argue that we are living at a moment of unprecedented rate of change right now. And the reason for that is generative AI, or AI finally being deployed in the real world. I would argue that this will, and already does, I'm sure, in a major way disrupt your whole field of education and learning. So I started, actually for me, AI is not new. I started on artificial intelligence research over 30 years ago in Brussels, Belgium. I got a PhD in AI. And I soon after my PhD moved to MIT, because MIT was truly, at that time, the mecca for artificial intelligence research. But I soon became disillusioned by what my colleagues were trying to accomplish with their AI research. The goal of AI was really to model intelligence in systems, computational systems, and to match or surpass people. And I was always more interested in, can we actually augment human intelligence? Can we improve human intelligence, possibly with some of these same techniques? So right now, 30 plus years later, I feel like my colleagues in AI are still doing the same thing. They're basically trying to reach AGI, general artificial intelligence, and they're very busy making their models smarter, more accurate, etc. But they basically have dropped this big box of AI in the real world without any considerations for what this will do to human intelligence, to have this artificial intelligence at our fingertips. So that's what my research is focused on. I would argue that it is very important to look at what happens to human intelligence when we are assisted in real time by AI. And the reason is that AI for the foreseeable future is actually more likely to be used as an augmentation rather than an automation. So it's likely that people will be in the loop in some way or other, whether they are actively working with the AI or maybe supervising whether the AI is doing the right thing, etc. Economists and management scientists such as Erik Brynjolfsson of Stanford, previously MIT, or Darren Acemoglu from MIT, argue that augmentation will lead to better societal and economic outcomes. I also believe that augmentation with AI will be necessary for the foreseeable future, because the current popular version of AI systems make a lot of mistakes. They hallucinate. So you need a human in the loop at some point to supervise the AI outcomes when it concerns really critical types of applications. I would also like to argue that for the foreseeable future, we need augmentation rather than automation, because many decisions and many processes that we are all taking every day in the real world require that people still have some understanding and control over the process, and that ultimately people are in charge rather than a system, for many reasons, legal reasons and more. So if we look at the spectrum of work out there, I would argue that collaborative work between an AI and a human will consist the majority of the work, and there's only a little bit of work and processes that can be fully automated, and there will also, of course, always be a small category of tasks, etc., that will be 100% human labor. So AI is not just an engineering challenge. Because AI has to work with people, it is very much a human design challenge as well. We have to design AI for working with people so that ultimately people plus AI result in the desired outcomes. So can AI improve decision making and critical thinking? I will show you that it is actually not, it doesn't necessarily follow that if you give a person one of today's AI systems, ChatGPT or whatever, that their critical thinking, their decision making improves. In fact, it can decrease in quality, and that's what our and other people's research shows. When I started playing with ChatGPT and these other generative models, the first thing, of course, we thought about was, whoa, what if you had this system right with you all the time when you're reading things, you're listening to talks like this one, etc., and this AI system can fill you in on things, can tell you when the speaker is BSing, bullshitting, for those of you that don't know that one, and so on. So that was sort of our first idea, that this would be great. We would augment human intelligence by giving them this AI that is constantly with them and trying to help them decide on the accuracy of statements that you come across. So we built this system and we started testing it, a system that is with you when you read statements. And we had three conditions. A control group did not have an AI. A second group had an AI that just would say, this is true or this is false when you heard something. And a third group had an AI that could also, that would explain itself. So it would say, this is true because, or this is false because. And what we learned was that when people get an AI that just tells them this is true, this is false, when they hear or read statements, they don't significantly actually change their opinion. But when they get an AI, when they have an AI helping them, that also gives an explanation, they do in a significant way change their own prior opinion about the veracity or the validity of the statement. So we thought this is great. Explanations are important. When AI gives explanations, then people will use its recommendations more often. But then we started thinking sort of from a devil's advocate point of view, well, if explanations are so powerful, are they maybe a little bit too powerful? So we did an experiment where we had people assisted by a malicious AI, an AI that tries to, in real time again, convince you that the opposite is true of the real veracity. So for example, and of course, by the way, it's super easy to instruct, to give a prompt to ChatGPT to make it be a malicious AI. So we just told it, give an explanation for why this truthful statement would be wrong, etc., or why this wrong statement would be true. And it easily came up with interesting explanations. We then did an experiment where we had people first tell us, we had 1,000 newspaper headlines. People would first tell us whether they thought the newspaper headline was true or false. Then they would get the honest or the deceptive AI, and they would again say, and it would give explanations, both of them, and they would again then say whether that statement was true or false. This is the result in light blue or all the way on the left in gray-blue. You see how good people are at discerning the accuracy of these newspaper headlines, true and false ones, without AI. In blue is with the AI that assists them in a good way, an honest AI. But in red, and on the left, you have the total, the left graph is actually the total number of statements. On the left, you see how much people's accuracy reduces when they have a malicious AI. So basically, malicious AI that gives you explanations works just as well as honest AI that gives you explanations. So we learned that actually what may be at stake here is that people are starting to overly rely on AI. They believe the AI too often, basically, especially when it gives explanations. And psychologists decades ago have shown similar things, that when you give an explanation for some bad behavior, people often accept it. Like if way back, Alan Langer, a psychologist at Harvard, did an experiment when people would still make photocopies. She would have a long line at the photocopy machine, and one person would come up and say to the front, "I'm so sorry, but I really have to make photocopies." And just because they gave a because, people would say, "Oh, sure, go ahead." So people don't necessarily process the explanation that is given. If there's an explanation, they often just glance over it and don't critically engage with it. So since then, we've been designing systems, interfaces for interacting with AI that are actually built differently. Right now, when you use AI, you give it a question, it gives you a page-long, usually, answer. And we've been changing that, and maybe it relates to Manu's work, actually, because we've been making the interaction such that the AI engages the user in more active thinking about the statement or the problem. For example, if one of our statements was, "Video games cause people to be aggressive because a gamer stabbed another person after being beaten in an online game of Counter-Strike." So if that is the statement, then you have to decide, is that overall statement true or false, that video games cause aggression? The system will not just say this is true because or this is false because, but instead it says, it engages the user in thinking and says, well, if one person stabs someone after playing a video game, do you think that follows that then lots of people will do the same thing? So the AI forces the person to be thinking more deeply. And again, we did experiments with that and showed that that did increase the accuracy of the discernments. So for AI to be useful and successful in a human context, I would argue that it's not just sufficient for AI models to be accurate and fair and accountable and explainable and align with human values, but they should also be designed to work with people so that the combined system of people with the AI together results in the desired outcomes. So that's sort of the approach that we take in our work. Most AI research is on the left. They optimize AI for certain outcomes, then they drop it like that box in the real world and see what they don't even see what happens. Our approach is one where we try to design by designing it with and for and together with target users to optimize certain outcomes or objectives. Now, a lot of our work in my group goes beyond just helping people with AI for like looking at information and deciding on or processing information. I think that one thing that is holding back a lot of young people from reaching their potential is that there's actually some other skills that they are lacking that prevent them from being successful. So it's not always information, knowledge, skills, but it's also things like attention, motivation, grit, attitude change, behavior change, etc., effective communication. These are all incredibly important skills that don't often get taught in school, actually, and cause a lot of people to fail. So we have been looking at whether AI could actually help with those types of soft skills that could help people become the person they would like to be. One experiment that we did, and again, this relates to what Manu was talking about, was during COVID, everybody was learning online. We were inspired by one teacher in Japan who would always change his own representation on the video into a cartoon manga character that was very popular. You know how you could like be a cat and so on. And it turned out that his students loved it, even though whatever he was teaching had nothing to do with that. So we thought, well, what is the effect of sort of chain of personification of AI systems? And this is important because Meta, for example, has 3 billion users, and its AI has faces. You choose the face of and the character you want to be your AI assistant. Tom Brady, who's a famous sports person in the US, and many other characters. So we did this experiment. We picked a person many people know, and back then, when we did the experiment in 2020, Elon Musk, who you may recognize, was more liked by more people. So we some people liked it. Many people liked him back then. Many people already didn't like him. But he was sort of a good choice. And then we had a non-existing person, same age, gender, race, etc.
I am a virtual agent generated to help provide information. Today, I'd like to tell you about a type of vaccine known as live attenuated vaccines.
So what
the info
we did
in this presentation
is we had virtual Elon Musk. He introduces himself. He says, I'm virtual, and the other one as well. And we have them give a lecture on vaccines, the topic du jour back then. And we did a between subject study with 134 participants where we looked at to what extent do you admire Elon Musk and how that correlated with learning outcomes. And we learned that the more people liked Elon Musk, the more they rated the instructor as a good instructor. And not just that, they also said, I want to learn more about vaccines. This was a really excellent lecture. I want to delve deeper into this topic, etc. Of course, if they hated Elon Musk, the opposite was true. But we thought that that was very interesting, that these characters can actually motivate people to learn, even though it's this element that has nothing to do with the topic necessarily. So we went a little bit further and we thought, well, what if for teaching history, I don't know about you guys, but it seems to me that history for most kids is always the least favorite topic in grade school. Of course, later you realize like how important history is. But we thought, well, what if we teach history with interactive characters? So we made this whole system where you can actually take a famous historical figure like Leonardo, but it can be anyone, and you can actually turn him into an interactive character to learn from him in his own words directly.
Hello, I am an AI-generated living memory of Leonardo da Vinci, an Italian Renaissance polymath.
So we have that virtual Leonardo who speaks to you and you speak to Leonardo in voice, and we built a whole architecture so we can easily make virtual Marie Curie, etc. We start with the primary sources that individual wrote. We then add secondary choices, biographies about the character, and we built a system that avoids hallucinations and inaccuracies by using what is called retrieval augmented generative AI. And so you can then come and talk to Leonardo about his machines, about where he lived, about who his mentors were, his the people that he taught, etc. And we did a study again, 90 students in this case, and learned that we had some people read a book about Leonardo, And so you see curiosity, learning effectiveness, and motivation in the graphs. Then we had a group of people that interacted with virtual Leonardo for the same amount of time, just question and answer. And already we had some improvement. However, for significant statistically significant improvement, we realized it was important that people first had to be introduced to Leonardo, because otherwise they didn't know what to talk about. So it was a little bit of a similar lesson where we learned you have to first introduce who this is, then you talk to him about whatever you want, and he pulls from his materials, and then that actually made significant difference in many of these learning outcomes. Another, apart from motivation, another problem for young and old people is attitude and behavior change. Very hard to help people with change in attitude, even if they may want to change. So let's first look at change of attitude. People always talk about AI being biased, and it's true. AI models typically are biased because they're trained on human data, and people are biased. But we thought, well, what if we, given that people are biased, people work with AI, what if we try to counter the bias of the user with an opposite bias in the AI? So we did exactly that experiment. We had an AI come up with problems for a set of, with solutions for a set of problems. And depending on what their own personal values were, we actually gave them either a neutral agent that had neutral values, or one that was aligned, so pro, or one that was against, had the opposite type of values as they did. And we had people come up with a solution to a problem in those areas where we test their bias. Then we had them work together with an AI to come up with a suggested solution. And we learned that, yes, you can actually counter the bias of an individual with the AI. Of course, if you give them an AI that is aligned with their values, that is also biased in the same way, you get even more extreme solutions. So it's very interesting. We may want to look at values of a user and then create or design an AI that can best complement them in a direction that we want to accomplish. What about behavior change? Another really hard problem. So many people work on trying to help people with behavior change and without much luck, including sort of novel technologies on wearables, etc. My student Pat, depicted there in the leftmost picture, created this system inspired by the work of psychologist Hal Hirschfield from UCLA, where young people, it's designed for people under 30, can upload their picture, and it first creates a prediction of what you may look like when you're 60, which you see at the bottom there. But then you also first tell the system about your goals. So you will say, for example, like the girl on the left said, I think I want to become a biology teacher, and I probably want to have two kids and live and teach in an inner city school, etc. And we sort of make a simulated future self, basically. So a guess as to how you, what may happen in your life from now till when you're 60, based on what you tell the system your goals are. And again, ChatGPT helps us with that because it has tons of information about biology teachers, what they studied, what their path was, what they like and dislike about their job, etc. And so in just a few minutes, you have a future possible self. We tell people this is not a prediction of what will happen, it's just one possible future self. And you can talk to that future self over chat. So you just tell it, like, tell me about a typical day in your life. What were some things that you really, some of the best moments in your career? What are some things you regret about being a biology teacher, etc.? So you talk to your future self, and that can help you with seeing that path from where you are to what you want to become, where what you want to change to. And we did, again, a study, 344 people, together with Hal Hirschfield, who focuses on this, and showed that people have less anxiety, or we had a control condition where people would just write about their future and what they imagine. People who used our system, the interactive system, had less anxiety about the future. They were more motivated to study and do the things that they want, that would lead to that future, etc. They had a higher, what is called, future self-continuity, which is the extent to which you think about longer-term goals in your day-to-day actions, etc. We also are now doing things like helping people learn about communication, for example, by rehearsing with simulated AI systems. All of us constantly have to have difficult conversations with family members, with colleagues, etc. We decided that maybe people could benefit, just like you were benefiting from talking to your older self. What if you can talk to a simulation of the person you need to have a difficult conversation with? Like, you need to talk to your boss about getting a raise or something. With this system, you can basically create a synthetic agent that represents your boss, and you can have this whole conversation with your simulated boss asking for a raise, so that then you can potentially have more confidence, etc., once you go in there and have the real conversation. So we did this and also looked at third person versus first person. We learned that what is most effective, basically, is the third person point of view, where you act like a theater director who directs you to interact with this other character. And we had significant difference there in terms of people's confidence level, their empathy for the other character, and their sense of comfort for having that discussion in real life. So to conclude, AI is not just an engineering challenge. It is very much a people challenge, a human design problem, as well as a human design opportunity. So we should really aim to design for optimal performance of the combined human plus AI system, because the system will affect people as much as whatever decisions are being made. I would argue that if we don't design AI with human considerations, human users in mind, that this can, in the long run, result in de-skilling, for example. If you rely on AI to always help you with problem solving, of course, you may not become very good at solving those problems yourself. Disconnection from the material, but also from other people. Disinformation, you saw in the work I presented earlier, how gullible people are. And you don't just want an AI to give you all the answers. The AI should know when you should know the answer, or you should know how to derive the answer. And dehumanization as well. Thank you.